this bidding. Okay, they're here. The third announcement is that the Lord, in His good and gracious will, has ushered out of this veil of tears the soul of our brother Eric Johnson. The family will hold a private family graveside service at Niobrara, and we're thankful that Pastor McReynolds is able to come back and comfort the family during this very difficult time, and that the elders in Arkansas were kind enough to grant him permission to make that trip. So we pray for his and his family's safe travel. Today on All Saints Day, the altar color is white, the color for heaven, joy, angels, light, Easter celebration. And we are singing hallelujahs because Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. We join in the first hymn.
Thank you.
beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Thank you.
mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us so to follow your blessed saints and all virtuous and godly living, that together with them we may come to the unspeakable joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Invisible.
this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number. This is our text. Please be seated. Dear fellow saints, death comes sometimes quietly, almost peacefully. Death sometimes comes quickly, tragically, violently. We want to turn back the clock and have more time. But however death comes, the Christian always falls asleep in Jesus. And whenever death comes, we pray in the funeral liturgy, Lord God, our shepherd, you gather the lambs of your flock into the arms of your mercy and bring them home. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe in and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Jesus promised the night before he died, in my Father's house are many rooms, I go to prepare a place for you. And home is one comforting picture of heaven. Here St. John was inspired by the Holy Spirit to give us another picture of heaven as a picture that we can draw and color by the numbers. And when the saints go marching in, we will be in that number. We consider this word of God under the theme, heavenly numbers we can count on. Numbers in the book of Revelation are symbolic. They are to be taken figuratively, not literally, like the numbers 4, 12, 7, and 10. The number 4 symbolizes or stands for creation, created things, the earth, mankind, human activity. For example, we speak of the four corners of the earth, the four winds, and the four directions of the compass. In Revelation, there are four living creatures at the throne of God, angels who represent all of God's creation. The first living creature looks like a lion, the strongest of the wild animals. The second living creature looks like an ox, the most powerful of the domesticated animals. The third living creature has the face of a man, the crown of creation and God's ordained ruler over creation. The fourth looks like an eagle, the mightiest of birds. These living creatures praise the triune God, saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was, who is, and who is to come. And they praise God as creator. You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. As we confess in the first article of the Apostles' Creed, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, including the land and the sea and the trees. And we say with Luther, I believe that God has made me and all creatures. We were created by God as individually and as specially as were Adam and Eve. And in a sense, we were with them in Genesis in the beginning. So when the saints went marching into the Garden of Eden, we were in that number, the number 4. And when Adam and Eve ate of the forbidden fruit, and all mankind fell, and one common sin infects us all, we rejoice that our first parents repented and trusted God's promise that the son of the woman would one day crush the serpent's head. And God himself, to show his grace and his forgiveness, shed the first blood and graciously clothed Adam and Eve with animal skins. They were forgiven, pure, holy saints in God's eyes. So when the saints went marching out of paradise into a fallen, thorn-infested, dying world, we were also in that number. Now we experience the same sickness, violence, and natural disasters that all people do. And as Christians, we also suffer the hatred of Satan, the persecution of the world, the pangs of conscience, and the loving discipline of our Heavenly Father. These troubles are pictured in the four horsemen of the apocalypse whom God permits to harm us. A white horse and its rider, representing man's insatiable hunger for power. A red horse and its rider symbolizing violence and bloodshed. A black horse and its rider indicating famine. And a pale horse and its rider death, given authority by God to kill by sword and famine and pestilence. John begins Revelation chapter 7 saying, "After this I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds to keep them from harming land or sea or tree. Another angel told the four angels, 'Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have put the seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God.' The trouble will come, but not until we are sealed. And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel." In other words, the whole number of God's people in Christ. 12 tribes in the Old Testament, 12 apostles and their followers in the New Testament. And likewise, the 24 elders around the heavenly throne represent all saints, the church of Old and New Testaments. The saints, dressed in white robes, holding palm branches in their hands, and casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea before the throne of God. A seal is a mark of ownership, like a brand. As we confess in the second article of the Apostles' Creed, "I believe that Jesus Christ has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, that I might be his own." In Revelation chapter 5, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fall down before the Lamb and sing a new song. "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth." We reign as kings with Christ right now, even though we don't look like kings, even though we don't feel like kings. The name Eric may mean powerful king. We are never victims. We are always finally victors. In Christ, we are lords over all things, even now. Therefore, all things, even death, must serve us in our eternal salvation. A seal is a promise of such eternal safety and victory. And we need that assurance because we are the church militant. We are the church on earth at war. The church on earth is pictured as the 12 tribes of Israel in battle formation. But outwardly, we look weak and defenseless. But when the saints go marching as to war, we will be in that number as well. Because we have been and are now signed, sealed, and delivered in our baptism. And the Holy Spirit uses signs, visible marks and actions in sealing God's people. Through these signs, baptism and the Lord's Supper, the Spirit confirms that we are, in fact, the children of God. His gracious activity results in our knowing that we belong to God and that He will protect us in our faith. And He will keep us safe in the midst of all the trouble we endure, working all things together for good. Because we are God's elect in Christ. In a presidential election, those with power and authority and free choice, that is, we the people, elect an individual in competition with other individuals to hold a position of responsibility and service. And that choice may be based on character, past performance, or promises for the future. And finally, the candidate is picked for a limited term, depending upon his or her performance or popularity. In fact, those who elected a person once may choose to unelect him or her the next time. God was the one with power and authority and free choice when He elected us to be His children, to live with Him forever in heaven, and to serve Him now as royal and holy priests. This election took place before creation, before we were born, before we had done anything good or bad. God chose us by grace alone, in connection with Jesus' suffering and death in our place, in connection with what the Holy Spirit would do in bringing us to faith, keeping us steadfast in the true faith until we reach our heavenly home. Our election was not based on character or merit or nationality or performance or good intentions or family connections. God did elect each one of us as an individual, but not in competition with others. And God did not choose us for a limited term subject to re-election. He elected us once for all eternity. And God did not elect us because he saw that in the future one day we would elect him as our God. Rather, we believe now because he first elected us. And the fact that we trust Christ at this time is the result of God choosing us before time. Those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. Those whom he justified, he also glorified. Glorified, past tense, because it is sure and certain. And we need these promises of God because we lose so much in life. Lose a game, lose a race, lose our keys, lose our shirt, lose our reputation, lose our concentration and our way, lose our battle with sickness, lose a loved one. But the church militant, the church at war, the church still fighting and struggling, has already won the victory in Christ. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. In fact, Jesus said we win by losing. Whoever saves his life for this world will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and for the gospel will find it in eternal life. Our good shepherd promises, my sheep listen to my voice, I know them and they follow me, I give them eternal life, they shall never perish, and no one and nothing can pluck them out of my hand. The trouble will still come, but nothing can truly harm us. Nothing can finally separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And soon and very soon, the church at war will be the church at rest, the church triumphant and victorious, the church in glory. In November, we observe Veterans Day and honor those who served our country in the armed forces. Well, today, All Saints Day, is Veterans Day in the church. Each and every Christian, man, woman, and child, is a soldier of the cross marching as to war with the cross of Jesus going on before. And when the saints go marching into heaven, we will be in that number. The number 7 symbolizes or stands for eternal blessings, the eternal Sabbath day's rest, heaven, and perfection. For example, the Holy Spirit is called the sevenfold Spirit because he's holy and perfect. John's book of Revelation, inspired by the Spirit, has 7 parts of 7 parts each. In John's Gospel, Jesus performs 7 miracles, including raising his friend Lazarus from the dead. Jesus speaks 7 times from the cross, including, Father, forgive them. It is finished. And today you'll be with me in paradise. And paradise calls to mind the Garden of Eden, the joy, the beauty, the intimacy with God. Here John describes the saints in glory this way. After these things I looked, and lo and behold, there was a large crowd that no one could count, from all 4 groups, every nation and tribe and people and language. Now Jesus had said, the gate is narrow and the road is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Jesus said, many are called, but few are chosen. Well, those few turn out to be quite a few. Not just from a few nations, but from every nation and tribe, people and language. Saints standing before the throne and before the Lamb, wearing white robes, holding palm branches in their hands. Christians have their robes washed white in the blood of the Lamb. Washed means we were once stained of sin and guilt, and now white. Not off-white, not gray, not beige, not dingy. We are perfectly pure, clean, holy, and forgiven in God's eyes. The word saint means holy one. We are the holy ones because we have the complete forgiveness of each and every sin through Jesus' death on the cross. Well, only God's blood can wash away sin. God the Son got his blood at Christmas. God the Son became the Lamb and shed his blood in the violent death. And now the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. Not some sins, not most sins, all. Christianity is a blood religion. We're washed in the blood in baptism. We drink the blood in communion. We wear the blood, as we'll soon sing, Jesus, thy blood and righteousness, my beauty are my glorious dress. We praise the blood now, O Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and we'll praise the Lamb and his shed blood for all eternity. eternity in heaven. For by death, Jesus destroyed death. His Easter victory assures us that we too shall rise with our bodies glorified like his. We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Jesus will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body. Thus we hold the palm branches of victory and sing with the saints and the angels a sevenfold hymn. Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. And then John ends this chapter with a tenfold description of the saints in heaven. Ten is the number of completion. In heaven we have complete joy, complete peace and rest. And John lists these ten truths. These are the people who have come through great suffering. They've washed their robes. They made them white in the blood of the Lamb. They are before the throne of God. They serve him day and night in his temple, not just one day a week or an hour a week, but 24/7. He who sits on the throne spreads his tent over them to shelter them. They will never be hungry again, never thirst again, nor will the sun overcome them or any burning heat. The word again means that now we do hunger and thirst and hurt and weep. But Jesus promises those who hunger and thirst for righteousness will be satisfied. In heaven, never again hunger, thirst, hurt, or weep. For Psalm 23 will still be true. Jesus will still be our shepherd and lead us to springs of living water. We believe at the banquet table furnished, our enemies will be powerless to interfere or to cause us to fear. And God himself will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Blessed are those who mourn on earth, for they will be comforted by God in heaven. God will not have the angels dry our tears, or the apostles Peter, James, and John to comfort us. God himself, a box of Kleenex, every eye, every person, every tear. As we confess in the third article of the Apostles' Creed, I believe in the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints. That is, all believers in heaven and on earth, one. One body of Christ, one family of God. And the communion rail illustrates this truth. The visible half circle of the communion rail is where we, the saints on earth, stand. The invisible half of the communion circle reaches into heaven, where the saints in heaven join us. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jeanette Hawthorne, Dan Pullen, Harriet Meyer, and now Eric Johnson. The Lord's Supper here is a foretaste of the feast to come and the family reunion to come. Many shall come from the four corners of the earth, sit at table with the 12 in the eternal 7th day's peace. God will look at each one of us in Christ and say, you are a saint. You are a 10. And when the saints go marching in, we will be in that number. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Please rise for prayer. Deliver those whom you have washed in baptism, granting the new life that death cannot overcome. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, you established the church and have granted her your aid and protection through these many years. Continue to pour out upon us your spirit and grace that we may accomplish your bidding and proclaim your sacred name to every corner of the earth. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, we give you thanks for the faithful pastors who have spoken to us your word, the church workers who have served us in your name. Grant that we may continue to receive their ministry of word and sacrament with willing ears and open hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, we beg your grace that our lives may be ordered by your commands, and we ask you to bless those who govern us in your name. Bless our president, the Congress, our governor, the legislature, all local officials, that pursuing the path of justice, they may act with humility and honor for the good of all people. Give wisdom to all who vote this week, and bless its result, that our nation may elect our leaders peacefully and orderly. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, we rejoice that you have rescued us from the power of death and raised us in Christ to dwell with him in everlasting life. Give to the family of Eric Johnson and to all who grieve the comfort of the promise of the resurrection of the dead and eternal life, and bestow your peace upon the dying that they may fall asleep here and awaken in your glory. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, you have made us your children, and you continue to guard us as your own possession. According to your will, give healing to the sick, calm to the troubled in mind, patience to those facing sorrow and struggle. Give health and peace to our nation, especially if we remember before you those we now mention silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, show forth your kindness to the poor and your compassion to those who suffer injustice. Deliver us from the scourge of racism and prejudice, and help us to acknowledge our common life from your creative power and our common redemption in Christ our Savior. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, we are unworthy of all your blessings and do not deserve the mercies due every morning of our earthly lives. Give us the will and desire to care responsibly for all that you have entrusted to us and to be generous with those in need, and for the support of your church and the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, your Son has set his table among us in the presence of our enemies, giving us a foretaste of the eternal feast to come. Prepare us in heart and mind to come to this sacrament and receive the blessing of his body and blood for our benefit. Deliver us from divisions that prevent our communion together, and bring us soon to the day when we will be fully united in doctrine and life to the glory of your holy name. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, bring us to that day when every tear shall be wiped away from our eyes, and we shall hunger and thirst no more. Knowing you now by faith, we yearn for the day when we shall know you face to face. Until the day of that eternal day, the dawn of that eternal day, keep us in your faith and fear through our good shepherd and Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. all your sins, gathered into the one body of your Son. You have surrounded us with so great a cloud of witnesses that we, encouraged by their faith and strengthened by their fellowship, may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,